So it's 2019, 4 years since Undertale came out, which is the perfect time for someone to explain why this ugly, goofy, clumsily written meme game is the only good game ever made. Well, I've got half an arts degree and, frankly, excellent taste, so I guess I'm the most qualified person here. Okay, classical sculpture aesthetic, royalty-free affixed twin deep cut, and you can't see, but I'm currently wearing a toga made of bedsheets. Credentials established, onto the matter at hand. Undertale has become a beloved game, and naturally, this has earned it some backlash. And to alienate the core audience for this video, I understand. It has plenty of pretty inexcusable failings. It's ugly as hell, it conveys criminally little sense of place through environmental design, which is painfully overbearing and linear to interact with. And Toby Fox's grasp of character voice and written dialogue is what we in the trade call...
actually pretty standard for video game writing.
Also, I know everyone loves the soundtrack, but... Seriously, can you guys think of another game whose fan games regularly surpass it in polish? But I think, aside from some shaky presentation, Undertale is a profound and complicated narrative work, deserving of scrutiny and preservation beyond its relevance to momentary subcultures. And I wanted to share some of the thoughts I had on the thing, what I think it's saying, how, and why. It took a while to convince me to play it, so a cursory glance, the game didn't really sell itself to me. I mean, for context, my other favorite game of all time has you playing a depressed, murderous sex pervert trying to survive a day in post-recession Detroit. But eventually, I relented. And once I'd finished, I'd been brought to tears by a game for the first time in my life. I felt moved in the practical sense of needing to reevaluate self-conceptions and behavior in a manner only a select few works of canon literature and film have managed previously. And I had all but abandoned my previous ideas about the direction of the medium and was full of exciting, confusing new ideas that I wasn't seeing discussed anywhere else. But while a good chunk of the world seemed to agree that they had had an important experience and that Undertale was a good game, most of the discussion I found was frustratingly superficial. If it even dealt with thematic material at all, as opposed to whether Sans was Ness from Earthbound or some silliness. My feelings about the thing were so intense that being an insufferably analytical person, I had to break them down and break down the thing that caused them. So I did. For about a straight year, with the help of some very clever and patient friends, I slowly developed a deeper reading of this thing. And after that, I spent another year writing several iterations of this script. And yeah, naturally, in the intervening time, some other clever bookers have started to articulate some of my points for me.
Wait, what's this?
It got me thinking about, well, what Undertale was actually about. That seems like a straightforward question,
three,
but for the life of me, I couldn't actually figure
three
out
days.
The answer. The
internet was three fucking days, are you kidding?
But I still feel there's a lot more to be said here. And yes, I'm aware that one of the most appealing qualities of Undertale is that it doesn't take itself too seriously, and I'm absolutely about to take it all too seriously. But, you know, welcome to YouTube. Undertale's not the sort of thing where there's like a single key to a big unifying metaphor or whatever, which makes everything neatly boiled down into a single thematic conceit. Trying to come up with a coherent reading of Undertale feels more like trying to read Shakespeare or Joyce than even, like, Tarantino. It conjures a dizzying array of themes and ideas with complex, sometimes nebulous and changing, but cohesive relationships, to the point where any single reading is naturally going to leave a lot of fascinating material unilluminated. Undertale provides rewarding readings through the lenses of psychoanalysis, existentialism, moral theory, queer theory, formalism, genre, etc., etc. So I'm just going to focus on a couple of the perspectives which stuck with me the most, and very broadly outline the conceptual logic Undertale works in. So let's be perfectly clear here. I'm not doing this for you. This is a fucking exorcism. Okay, and before I proceed, first, I feel I should say I read this thing as going to some pretty dark places in subtext and surface text. So I'm going to be discussing some emotionally charged thing. You know, just a fair warning if you don't want to handle that. Secondly, while normally I'm a little skeptical that spoiling narratives is really as harmful to the experiences people make out, Undertale really is an exception to that. And I know there's nothing more annoying than someone telling you to go into an experience knowing as little about it as possible. So, like goddamn magic, I'm actually going to give a reason. Undertale anticipates and reacts to the decisions that you make, which will be strongly influenced by any knowledge of the plot, gameplay, and meta, and the experience will be materially different based on those decisions. Also, you know, I'll try to explain things as I go, but this is probably going to make a lot more sense if you know what I'm talking about. So if I've given you maybe the slightest inkling that there might be anything in this game for you and you haven't played it yet for some reason, this is probably the place where you should stop and play the game.
Woo! Here we go!
Okay, so when it was first released, a lot of the discussion around Undertale was focused on its self-reflective and subversive formal qualities. In particular, its improvement of the turn-based RPG combat system and its critique of the use of violence as shorthand in games and the limits of the sort of stories that can be told through that. For example, in lots of conventional games, indiscriminately killing everything you come across is rewarding and largely free of consequence. But in real life, those actions tend to be punished. Undertale boldly draws attention to this discrepancy. Congratulations on picking out the most boring and obvious things in the game. Looking back on the game's lauded as artistic advancements in recent memory, it seems formal deconstruction and the medium as subject matter are disproportionately common themes.
He then praised the game for its insightful and witty commentary into the nature of video game structure and its examination of structural narrative tropes.
Being charitable, I'd attribute this to a commendable self-awareness of the immaturity and limitations of our current understanding and of techniques within the medium. Being less charitable, you could be forgiven for concluding that games are only good for discussing themselves.
In fact, I'm just going to say that no one who's listening to this is lucky.
As such, a lot has been made of Undertale's formalism, but what interests me more, and the aspect that I want to highlight here, is how Undertale's formal qualities are all in service of broader, universal, emotional themes, and how those themes are why it had such an impact on its players and why it will last in their memories. Like, if you want to have a good time, just watch one of those screamy Let's Players get to the comforting Asriel scene, and then suddenly they get all quiet and weird as they struggle with the fact that they're actually genuinely getting an emotion and they don't know what to do. Okay, so, at the time Undertale was being developed, lots of indie games were affecting the 8 and 16-bit retro pixel tune vibe.
I know, this is exactly the kind of cutting insight you were hoping for, but wait, huh?
It's easy just to attribute this to a kind of communal identity stylistic thing, and it kinda is, but it's interesting to consider the different ways this conceit works in the context of different games. Shovel Knight, for example, is strictly an attempt to faithfully recreate the experience of a 16-bit Nintendo platformer, with strict adherence to the limitations and design philosophy that led to the creation of that aesthetic, as well as lots of well-regarded games. Meanwhile, Hotline Miami uses its retro graphics and arcade-inspired fast-paced gameplay as part of a general skewed textural callback to the 80s excess, which is its subject matter. Undertale, assy as it looks, uses its retro stylistic affectations to put its older players into a nostalgic, emotionally receptive and childlike mindset. This is compounded when we are introduced to Toriel in the first moments of the game, who, while being a parody of frustrating overbearing tutorial design haha Toby Ucard, nonetheless infantilizes the player in a very real, dramatic sense. This is our introduction to what I believe is the most important theme in Undertale when examined as a conventional narrative. That is nostalgia and escapism, and the extent to which they can be healthy or maladaptive. It seems to me that the normalization of geek culture over the past few years has kind of fed into a slight but important change in the way that people think about and analyze stories in popular discourse. Emphasis is placed less on a story's meaning and context as a thing made by a person to express a thing to other people, and more on the literal internal logic of what is actually happening in the fake imagined world of the story. And like, on the one hand, these discussions can be totally valid, and at best they can bring a new insight into the broader meaning and worldview represented in a work. On the other...
And look at the way he stands! I always thought it was awkward until I looked at the two characters side by side. Papyrus's curved arm and hand is a direct match to the curved arms of the Starman in the Mother series.
On the other hand, these discussions seem less interesting to me, and at worst, maybe a maladaptive way of trying to make an imagined and therefore inherently more anthropocentric world as convincing as can be in order to sustain the disengagement with a horrifying, painful, messy, real one as long as possible. It is also interesting to note that this has coincided with the growing dominance of media based on pre-existing IP and grown-up revivals of nostalgic crap that I'm sure you don't need me to point out. Undertale, being conceived during Toby's time as a prominent member of the Earthbound and Homestuck communities, emerged from the epicenter of this environment and seems to be a reaction to it, carefully and critically examining nostalgia and escapism as the universal human traits that give rise to it. Once you've noticed this, you begin to see it everywhere. Toby has specifically stated the evocation of nostalgia to be the motivation behind the extensive use of leitmotif in the game soundtrack. The most illustrative example being how, in the epilogue, as you backtrack through all the places you've passed, visiting them for the last time, you're treated to a medley of important themes, now rendered in high-fidelity samples with modern, realistic reverb effects, as opposed to 8-bit chiptune loops. This reflects Frisk seeing the familiar from a new, more nuanced and adult perspective in light of all they've experienced. Of course, it would be much more effective if it weren't using these horrible Chrono Trigger sound fonts. That slap bass is literally a crime. And note that, like the off-putting saccharine tone, it evokes the stories we are told as children. The coming-of-age hero's journey story form also, at its core, is about contrasting childhood and adulthood. Also, like, did you notice that every boss character is in some way living some kind of harmful, escapist or nostalgic fantasy? Toriel claims fallen kids to try and recreate her idealized past home life. Papyrus spends his life in cosplay. Undyne believes anime is real and has accordingly built her identity around shonen archetypes. Alphys engineers elaborate but shallow social situations that allow her to pretend she's not terrible. Asgore spends his time not tending to his decaying kingdom, but rather gardening and nurturing the yellow flowers that were his lost child's favorite, to keep the reality of his depravity at bay. And that depravity itself is a performative gesture towards reclamation of a former home.
Please don't leave any hurtful comments about living in a past where people still care about Undertale analyses.
It's not always bad. It's made pretty clear that there's plenty of occasions where indulging a little bit is healthy and even necessary if you're aware of what you're doing. I mean, at the end of the day, Undertale is itself a nostalgic escapist throwback to nostalgic escapist experiences that I don't think Toby regrets having. The problem is, recreating the past is kind of a contradiction in terms, like darkness visible, sweet sorrow, or American cuisine. You're never going to be able to build a satisfying recreation because the conditions which gave rise to the past are nothing like the present. If you even are accurately remembering the past in the first place. And, you know, not even mentioning the fact that the past gave rise to this present that you're finding dissatisfactory. For example, Toriel can move back to her old home and set up all the furniture just as she remembers and coddle any fallen children that come through, but the fact that the world has changed around her and that her motivation in raising Kara and Asriel wasn't to recreate the good times of raising Kara and Asriel means that the actual emotional reality to these moments is going to be inherently different. And when this facade is threatened, her attempts to protect it harm her ability to be the ideal mother she'd like to be. To an extent, the entire culture of the underground is predicated on the fantasy, founded on lies of an eventual escape to the surface. Which is particularly interesting because the underground is a setting the players literally choose to escape to themselves, in reality and the fiction narratively symbolized by falling into the underground. Kara goes underground because they hate people, and so they spend their life hanging out with endearing monsters instead. During Asriel's epilogue speech, he mentions how the overground isn't actually as nice a place as the monsters seem to think. In this way, the overground is reality and the underground is the game, or more generally, fantasy, in a consistent metaphor. The breaking of the barrier is depicted as the screen, the fourth wall breaking apart. It is the threshold between fantasy and reality. Don't worry, Lacan, I'll get to you, calm down. Okay, this music is getting on my nerves now.
To detect.
Hang on a sec.
Did somebody knock off the blue
The alignment. Today? What stones are you talking about?
Oh, now you don't know what...
There you go. Perhaps the most interesting expression of this theme, though, is actually kind of dark, and that is suicide. This fucking baby game for children is so full of suicide, I was tempted to call the whole video Undertale and the Death Drive. Flowey wants to die, Alphys wants to die, Asgore wants to die, Kara wanted to die, it's implied Frisk wanted to die.
Please let me go. I've done everything.
Whoa, hold the phone there, buddy. What exactly does this have to do with nostalgia and escapism?
No. You are the crazy person. In Undertale, suicide is the ultimate escape into an artificial, anthropocentric, and self-defined state of being. Toby links these themes in a bunch of ways. Consider that if the barrier is a consistent symbol for the line between fantasy and reality, by implying Frisk and Kara were attempting suicide and falling underground, the game is literally equating your decision to play with suicide. Also note that all of the suicidal characters previously listed resort to it as an escalation of their failed escapist adaptations. It's not just harm to self either, like, this fantasization is motivating these people to murder children. I see some precedent for this idea in Freud's notion of a death drive, a fundamental unconscious urge in all things to return to an idyllic state of unlife, which he began to develop after finalizing the more intuitive notion of a psychological drive towards pleasure, upon noticing that his model didn't account for certain kinds of behavior. Soldiers returning from the First World War suffered nightmares and flashbacks reliving their trauma. Toddlers played games reenacting scenes they found distressing, and victims of abuse often find themselves more likely to be re-victimized or even become abusers themselves. So, like, what is actually going on in a person's head when they're doing this? Perhaps in recreating traumatic experiences, we seek to recontextualize them and maybe take some sort of agency over them. Hey, doesn't that sound like someone we know? Guess it's time to talk about the best character in video games. Move over, James, nobody loves you anymore. I won't lie, I fucking love Flowey the Flower. He fills such a number of disparate narrative roles so effectively. At different points, he manages to be, like, creepy weirdo, threatening villain, pathetic loser, utterly alien Aphex Twin Cthulhu, transitional object, and... She's a Soligari, I guess. If you want to read Undertale as a character study, I'd say Flowey is its subject. Mental illness is another of the themes Undertale seems interested in exploring, and in my opinion, I think it comes out with one of the most well-observed, sympathetic depictions of the issue in the medium. As I'm sure has been pointed out already, anyone with experience of chronic depression would find a lot to relate to in Flowey's genocide monologues. But what I found particularly affecting and relatable is his inconsistency and self-sabotage. He alternately aids and hinders the player. In one set of circumstances, he will beg for death, while at the same point in another timeline, he will utterly debase himself to save his own life. Yet, all of this feels perfectly emergent from a consistent psychology. He is insane, but not as a black boxy plot device excuse for implausible behavior to artificially engineer conflict. He is comprehensibly, realistically, and predictably incapable of rational interaction with the world. And importantly, even though it's told through analogy with a metaphoric fantastical plot device with the soul as the capacity for a healthy emotional range, in a pretty bold and honest turn, by the end of his arc, he is not cured. You know, a mental disorder isn't something that can be fixed with a moment of lucidity or single experience, no matter how powerful they might be. This sadomasochistic self-negation touches on something a little deeper, though. What I absolutely love about this character is how he shines a harsh light on the tragic contradictions in the human condition. Flowey is, in a conventional sense, highly empowered. He is deathless, and with a metaphoric ring of gaijus, he needs to suffer no consequences for his actions. Both of those things are intuitive things to desire, yet this is precisely why he is so miserable. His condition is the most lucid illustration in fiction I know of a concept at the center of Lacan's psychoanalytic theory. That of objet petit a, the immaterial, inescapable absence of the object of all desires which we strive to fulfill with goals, possessions, and experiences, which are always a symbolic substitute for the fulfillment of a. Yet that very striving is the currency and structure of your consciousness itself, and cannot be eliminated no matter how good you are at attaining your symbolic desires. Consequently, Flowey's sense of distinction between self and the outside world is blurred. As he is able to utterly control everyone around him, they are no longer external objects and thus cannot be attained, thus he cannot strive. Flowey has everything he wants, and that is why he is so miserable. It's important to note here that all of Flowey's psychotic behavior is in some way an attempt to recreate his past. His persona as Flowey seems to be an imitation of all the things he found charismatic in Kara, including the spooky faces. As a victim turned abuser, his torture of Frisk at the end of the neutral route is an elaborate recreation of his own trauma, placing himself in control, culminating in an almost fetishistic fixation on forcing Frisk to repeat his own cry for help. It doesn't really work out for him. See, even someone with the superpower to return things exactly to an earlier state, exactly as they were, even when he can magically sidestep the whole entropy thing, reliving the same events again and again leads to ever-diminishing returns, because in order to experience it, you yourself are changing. Let me pose a non-sequitur question. What defines and creates tragedy, the sort of unique, bittersweet feeling that you get from certain stories? The intuitive answer is like sad things happening to a character you care about that make them sad, right? Like, the more bad things have happened to a character and the more sad they are, the more tragic they are. But if that were the case, then something like the movie Martyrs would be the most tragic thing of all time. And it's not exactly a fun watch, but it's not going to bring a cathartic tear to my eye either. No, I'd say the essence of tragedy is in fact regret. Not how bad a character's situation is, but how responsible they feel.
A serviceable backstory is one where something bad happens to the character. A much more compelling backstory is one where something bad happens to the character, and they blame themselves for it.
This is why classical tragedy deals with mostly decent people bringing suffering upon themselves by their worst inclinations. Why the discussion of fate versus agency and where personal responsibility fits into that is such a prominent recurring theme. And why the peak of classical tragedy is the moment where the character realized how much they goofed and what they've become. This is why the most poignant moments of any tragedy are those which juxtapose the pain of the present with the memory of a happy, uncomplicated, innocent past. So if you agree that a longing for the past, for better or worse, is a significant thematic focus for Undertale, it follows Undertale is uniquely poised to evoke and conceptually explore tragedy. Now, as a lazy armchair narratologist, I would divide the Western tragic tradition broadly into two camps. I'd contrast the classical tragedy, described by Aristotle, firmly rooted in classical character ethics, as driven by an ordered, anthropocentric universe deeply concerned with justice and human affairs, going out of its way to punish bad behavior stemming from flawed character, with what I'd call the existential tragedy, set in a much more uncertain universe with no clear teleology to existence. Starting more or less with Shakespeare, these more recent pieces are fixated with and draw their tragedy from the arbitrariness, facticity, thrownness, whatever, of their characters' existences, circumstances, and fates. Think of the number of times a Shakespearean tragic character expresses uncertainty about the afterlife, or turns to God for direction only to be met with a hollow silence in place of the metaphysical reassurance of a Greek chorus. Just saying, as flies to wanton boys, are we to the gods? They kill us for their sport? Sure as hell evokes Cthulhu more than Yahweh or even Zeus to me. Now, a lot of these characters have done something stupid or wrong and still feel some responsibility, but no audience would consider the fallout just. Undertale kind of flirts with the trappings of both. Flowey's subtextual background art is a point-per-point example of Aristotle's ideal tragic hero, being a literally and figuratively noble, fortunate guy brought low by an error of judgment stemming from an overabundance of an otherwise admirable trait, to depravity and misfortune, and has a painful moment of agnorisis becoming an object of simultaneous fear and pity. He even does the Oedipal parent murder thing, the killing of a family member being, in Aristotle's opinion, the most tragic act there is. Also, the etymological root of the word tragedy translates to something like Song of the Goat. Is that a coincidence? Okay, but the title said this was an existential tragedy, so let me talk about Sans. Sans and Flowey are opposed and contrasted in a lot of different ways, actually. They both exhibit depressive symptoms, they both go out of their way to gain your trust with friendliness while secretly contemplating murdering you. They're the only two characters with knowledge of the meta-narrative, they're both surprise endgame bosses who exploit the meta-knowledge in their fights, and they're the only characters I'd say Toby uses as something of a mouthpiece. Sans's arc, in contrast to Flowey's, is defined by his powerlessness. I think this dichotomy is symbolically illustrated in their faces. Flowey can make his face, being made out of amalgamate goop, into any shape, and thus has plenty of agency, but his identity is compromised. Sans, while watching the blissfully ignorant frolic about in a doomed world, can't do anything but grin because his face is a skull. He's smiling, and he hates it. In fact, the cause of most of his suffering throughout most of the game is just the existential dread from knowing too much and being unable to share his knowledge with the rest of the world. His tragedy has a lot in common with Hamlet. He is a witty, depressive intellectual playing the fool to divert attention from his plans, torn between conflicting values and plagued by an uncertainty, which causes him to hesitate in killing the villain until it's too late. But in this version, the wacky, goofy, fun character whose disembodied skull represents the ultimate triumph of death and futility is actually shown being wacky and goofy and fun before they die. This is one of the many ways in which Undertale is objectively superior to Shakespeare. This puts Sans, on the other hand, firmly in the existential tragic hero camp. There is nothing he can do to change his fate or that of the world. He's just happened to be thrown into this shitty situation. So, where does Undertale's worldview fall on the spectrum then? Let's look at one more tragedy. It's a tired truism in drama that effective villains tend to be dark mirrors to the protagonist, showing similar traits, circumstances or values just slightly twisted into something darker. In this way, Flowey is the perfect dark mirror, not to Frisk, but to the player themselves. You've probably already heard this one before, but just to quickly cover it. You know how, like, in GTA, after doing all the missions, it seems to be human nature to start going on killing sprees? To the point where not taking the characters in the world seriously has been kind of baked into the design of the game these days. Like Flowey, the ideal player initially engages with the game in good faith, treating the characters as people, sincerely attempting to help with their problems. Till eventually the behaviors of the other characters become so predictable the illusion of them as people breaks down, and you begin to feel fewer qualms with harming them for more novel experiences.
It's an incredible performance of this surplus pleasure, not only deprived of all pleasure, but surplus pleasure in the very form of promising extreme suffering. You don't get any pleasure, you will see how, be careful what he's saying. He's not saying there will be harsh time, but don't worry, it will not be too bad, we will win. He promises just more misfortune. He says, almost in the Kantian way of Sublime, do you want a war so total that you cannot even imagine how total will it be? Do you want to work 10, 12, 16 hours per day? Do you want to suffer deprivations that you cannot even imagine today? And the crowd shouts, yes, yes, yes. This is surplus pleasure at its purest.
The perfect ending is, like any object of desire in reality, made bittersweet and maybe the slightest bit unsatisfying. Turns out you can't save everyone. After a good 20 minutes of singular focus on making you root for Azrael, all the superpowers and minigames and flirting in the world, Hart changes resolve to do the closest thing to suicide he is capable of. This is juxtaposed with the happiness of the rest of the cast who must remain in ignorance. And even those guys you're going to have to leave behind. So, despite being warned, you're compelled to go back and replay the game and violate the trust of the lovable characters precisely because you love them so much. You're going to want to go back to try and recreate that magical but not quite perfect experience you had the first time you played, and you're going to keep on doing it to ever diminishing returns in a compulsive ritual of distilled Lacanian jouissance. One of the truly moving things about Undertale is that more so than pretty much any other game, the player themselves is a character in the drama. This is where the diegesis of saving and loading serves as more than just a cocky deconstructive meta-commentary on video game form. It makes the player join the time-honored ranks of tragic heroes fruitlessly chasing objets de A against the constraints of the universe, irrationally striving to command back time itself and destroying what they love in the process. Like Holden Caulfield, Jay Gatsby, Shigekuni Honda, and Flowey before them, it provides an environment for you yourself to learn, not to watch other people learn and maybe observe some life experience vicariously. Not only can we imagine anyone in Azrael's circumstances falling from grace, but we're placed there to experience it ourselves. Only, unlike him, we maybe have the freedom to walk away once we're done. This insight shows even the classical trappings of Flowey's tragedy to be superficial. The narrative logic and philosophy is existential all the way through. Remember, at the climax of his weird psychodrama, Frisk calls for help and help arrives. His agnorisis is the moment when he realizes that even his bleak nihilistic worldview has failed him. It is not a universal meta-narrative. He is not the Übermensch, and there was not even any empowering learning from his trauma, which was truly an arbitrary, cruel, meaningless twist of absurd fate. Like American cuisine. So I guess in the end, the philosophy of Undertale is in a cold and unjust universe, we must create our own justice, and we'd be wise to make it a compassionate and understanding one. Good job, guys. Well done. Well done, everyone. We all understand Undertale now. We can go home. There's no more video left. That's the end of the... Oh, no. But Undertale isn't a conventional narrative, so how do we analyze it? Well, there's an answer. You gotta stop finicking with all this literary, textual, thematic bullshit and start thinking about Undertale's subversive formal qualities. I mean, obviously, who told you not to do that? Because they're an idiot and you should stop listening to them. Do you remember in that horrific primordial chaos before the glorious consumer rights revolt? Before The Escapist was gutted of its interesting critical and theoretical articles about what games are, could be, and how? Do you remember how the phrase Citizen Kane of games kept coming up? It reflected the optimism of an era, as opposed to the weird complacency that superseded it. Acknowledging the faults in the art form they loved and worked in, games criticism looked towards the development of film, another post-industrial technological art form, from frivolous novelty to the most powerful medium of culture in the world. It embodied a near messianic expectation of a game, presumably the product of a great auteur, that would push the techniques of game design to new limits, abandoning the customary schlocky subject matter and present a genuinely sophisticated and important artistic vision, teaching us all how to make and read games and legitimizing the medium in the eyes of the Roger Eberts of the world.
Action awesome, please.
You just do anything?
No, it's sorry, cut.
Well, the whole idea was dumb, not in the least because Citizen Kane was not the Citizen Kane of movies. The development of such a nuanced and rich medium as that of film was gradual and incremental, requiring the tiny contributions of countless visionaries over decades of work and hundreds of individual films. That said, though, Undertale is totally the Citizen Kane of games. Let me qualify. In amongst the subversive formal qualities and annoyingly meta, self-aware experimentation, I think Undertale hit on something big and something that nobody else seems to be talking about. To continue the cinema analogy and painfully oversimplify some of film history, back when film was in its infancy and beginning to be considered as an artistic medium as opposed to a novelty, early practitioners and theorists were confronted with a question. They called it the question of medium specificity. That is to say, when most films were composed of just long, static wide shots of actors just doing the action, why is this any different to theatre? What can we do here that we can't do in theatre? And thanks to the hard work of racists and propagandists, we eventually came to realise that the essence of cinematic form was in the edit, the way ideas can be uniquely juxtaposed by cutting the movement of camera to create new kinds of meanings that were impossible to elegantly express before. The thing is, people have been experimenting with editing for some time, so to us, that might seem a little obvious in hindsight, but it took the theoretical leap and some concerted, systematic, and creative experimentation to give us the techniques and grammar now vital to what we think of as a movie today. Games have pretty clearly been struggling with the same problem for a while now. We want to tell more sophisticated, meaningful, and serious stories that don't embarrass us to play, but most of the time we end up with weird movies that keep pausing for endless repetitive action scenes. Okay, so what is the medium specificity of video games? I've heard the argument that games, through challenging you with pressures that you wouldn't face in ordinary life, can function as empathy machines, putting you in the shoes of people and circumstances you would never experience to maybe get a sense of what it's like to be someone you wouldn't otherwise associate yourself with. And I guess that's sort of fair to say that games are potentially better at this than other media, but it's something that, ideally, all drama tries to do to varying degrees of success. Besides, in my opinion, some of the most interesting game narratives rely on intentionally alienating you from the player character. Maybe it's the uniquely immersive sense of place that exploring a simulated environment in a game can give you. That used to be my way of thinking. The freedom to explore a creation on your own terms, making it less subject to presentation. That feeling of discovery and finding a piece of purely environmental storytelling. The personal sense of intimacy and voyeurism you get from being responsible for choosing to rifle through someone's drawers or diary. It's pretty powerful stuff, but again, more textural than substantial. It doesn't really convey much meaning that couldn't be conveyed in another medium. Also, case in point, Undertale is terrible at this, but it still managed to shake me to my core. Okay, so here's my hot take. Undertale illustrates that games can convey unique ideas through the thoughtful juxtaposition of different eventualities. The core of what makes Undertale a great game and a great story that could only be told in the medium of gaming is that the majority of its theme and pathos is expressed with a sort of subtext that arises from how different paths comment on each other laterally. For example, when you analyze each of its branches as conventional linear stories, you find that they each seem to make three very different didactic points and express three different worldviews. In isolation, as a linear narrative, the thesis of the pacifist route seems to be that the power of love can redeem and overcome all, and goodness always prevails. The genocide route, however, is a cosmic horror story in which you take the role of the unstoppable, incomprehensible abomination from beyond the limits of the world's understanding, destroying a civilization on a whim, just for the sake of doing all the things you can possibly do, as the people around you slowly come to terms with just how alien and impenetrable to reason this motivation is. It's bleak and tragic, with themes of heroism being futility in an inevitably cold and unjust world. Without this context, the true pacifist ending can feel saccharine and hollow to jaded depressives like myself, which in itself does not fairly summarize the nuanced attitude and worldview expressed in Undertale as a whole. In the context of genocide, though, when these two situations are part of the same story, the pacifist ending becomes cathartic, a redemptive, bittersweet, isolated victory against the absurd. The details on the depths of Asriel's depravity and the sympathetic description of the suffering that caused it, only gleaned in genocide, makes his redemption more powerful. Likewise, without the context given in the pacifist route for all of these characters' personal lives and the charm of normal life in the underground, without knowing what is being lost, genocide is kind of dry and devoid of emotional meaning. With the whole possibility space considered, the attitude expressed becomes that in an unfeeling, arbitrary, unjust universe, goodness doesn't need to be inevitable or powerful to be valuable and worth fighting for. Also, this branching structure and the agency you are given to navigate it gives Undertale a license to contain a massive panoramic sweep of emotional range, which would be very difficult to include in a linear narrative without this, like, massive tonal whiplash. Yes, you can sort of approach something like this in non-linear films. You have your things like Run Lola Run, where you can see different eventualities play out, but there's a reason most movies haven't picked this up. It's kind of clunky and it draws out your runtime and demands that each branch must be shorter and less complex. You're also forcing the audience to sit through this whole unnatural experience of time instead of just letting them explore it on their own terms. Whereas in Undertale, it's like looking at a statue from another angle. You know, some of the effect of cinematic montage could be suggested by, like, the triptych, but it's not quite the same. Okay, I can hear you asking, is he talking about multiple endings? Games have had that shit for years. And yes, but no. Before I played Undertale, I actually kind of had a deep dislike for branching narratives.
I have no choice but to...
If you want Calculon to race to the laser gun battle in his hover Ferrari, press 1. If you want Calculon to double-check his paperwork, press 2. Enter now.
There are plenty of branching narrative games that I've loved. You know, I grew up in the 90s. It was pretty hard to avoid the things. But it always felt like a tacked-on gimmick, or a reward for higher-level play as opposed to a deep technique in service of theme. In Oddworld, for example, if you don't save 99 Madottans at the climax in a cutscene in his darkest moment, Abe is abandoned and killed. That's not really a new sort of narrative, that's a conventional narrative with an unsatisfying climax because you didn't play well enough. And neither branch really gives much meaning to the other. The same goes for most moral choice systems, even more complicated ones like Mass Effect. True, the Paragon Renegade thing provides more branches, but here, at best, it serves as a textural tool for greater engagement, on the premise that you will be more immersed in the character and the world if you feel free to make choices like you can in reality, though that is somewhat hampered by the fact that every choice is given this big, gamey, glowy neon sign around it. I fucking hate games so much. And on the few occasions where it's used well to make interactive the sort of moral thought experiments that you'd see in something like Star Trek, which is a cool idea, each branch is immediately labeled according to the escapist moral fantasy of your choosing, boiling morality down to a fucking point system, holy shit. The fact remains that I can't think of another game where having knowledge of one branch gives subtext and extra meaning to the events of another. The important thing that distinguishes Undertale from these other examples is that it can only be successfully passed as media with at least an understanding of the content exclusive to the neutral, true pacifist, and genocide realms. Just as the edit juxtaposes ideas in a unique way, creating new meaning and emotional affect, games juxtapose ideas across possibility space. It suggests a hitherto neglected path towards an effective grammar of game design without totally understanding it or codifying it, and it makes me really excited to think about, in the way that the Moscow Film School must have felt watching Birth of a Nation trying to extrapolate from that a theory of montage. Okay, so let's try and take this further. What new interactivity unique meaning does Undertale convey with this powerful tool?
Sir, you write "born to kill" on your helmet and you wear a peace button. What's that supposed to be, some kind of sick joke?
No, sir.
What is it supposed to mean?
I think I was trying to suggest something about the duality of man, sir.
The what?
Okay, so Undertale is a highly moralistic game, but everyone seems to get its moralism kind of wrong. Superficially, it seems to be a parable of non-violence and pacifism, but this doesn't quite hold up. Frisk is only at liberty to choose non-violence in all circumstances because they have superpowers, and the game acknowledges this. And it certainly endorses violent resistance against Kara as heroic. So, what is it actually saying, and why is it so focused on the relative moral standings of its characters? Why are so many of these characters of dual nature, with each of them even being distinguished with different visual designs? It's not arbitrary. By juxtaposing equivalent events in different contexts and branches, it makes it abundantly clear how much what we would intuitively attribute to someone's moral character is determined by their circumstances, using interactivity to make a point that could only be elegantly and compellingly made with interactivity. This is a concept called moral look, which, while it's arguable it's been a question at the heart of tragedy for millennia, was only recently codified. Coined by Bernard Williams and further developed by Thomas Nagel, moral look was in part developed in order to account for the mind-boggling number of seemingly ordinary people who participated in the monumental evil of the Holocaust. And to be clear, I'm not saying Toby necessarily read Nagel and was like, man, you know what would be a great way to illustrate the human implications of this? A game about sexy skeletons. But I think this is actually quite an intuitive notion, and its academic expression reflects its relatively recent appearance in the zeitgeist, for obvious reasons. So it could very easily have been bouncing around half-consciously in the back of his head independently. Nagel preferred using 4 categories to describe moral look, but I think the neatest to use is 3, each of which are exemplified in Undertale. 1 is where circumstance determines whether a person's better or worse nature shows itself. Another is where a person experiences different personal moral growth, depending on external circumstances. And the third is where the same person can make exactly the same choice with exactly the same foreknowledge, and things they were unaware of when making that choice determine whether the common sense view of morality would condemn them. Okay, so Undyne is fun. We all love her, but she's got some pretty harmful tendencies, right? She values violence, a romanticized ideal of the warrior hero, communal unity against a hostile, simultaneously all-powerful yet inferior other. She has a sense of national humiliation, and in one ending literally leads an armed revolt against the aristocratic class to instill a populist, militarized government around herself as charismatic leader, and starts preparing for a self-destructive retaliatory war to cleanse the world of humans. Also, like, if she were online, she'd totally have an anime avatar. However, she also has some pretty admirable traits, which earn her the explicit title of true hero from the narrative. She doesn't overcome the hatred of humans like she does during the date scene. She doesn't learn or grow. She just sets aside her fuckier hang-ups for the time being and sacrifices herself for a world she has an ambivalent relationship with. Alphys, for no reason but to further her pathological quest to control every aspect of how people view her and make them play into her weird fantasy self-image, keeps the mutilated victims of medical experimentation trapped and hidden in an unlit basement while lying to their families. In neutral, that's just where she is at the end of her story. In pacifist, her hand is forced, and with her secret exposed, she has no option but to confront the aspects of herself she wants to ignore. In genocide, however, faced with a threat like Kara, she learns to value the lives of her fellow monsters more than her charade, and opens the lab, exposing her secret, to harbor civilians of her own accord. Sans, keeping Toriel's promise, chooses not to kill Frisk the moment he sees them. In pacifist, this is a good call. In genocide, though, it's the literal end of the world. In doing this, in showing all of these characters at their best and worst at the whims of circumstance, Undertale elucidates the mechanics of the existential tragedy in a way that nothing else really can. And just to twist the knife, these people's best, most transcendent selves only show themselves when they're about to die in the scenario with the bleakest ending. God, this game is so good. Again, I'm reading pretty deeply here, but the important part is that this isn't like a secret hidden message for the smart people. Everyone got this. Little kids learning to draw got this, even if it wasn't consciously articulated in the discourse. I always figured fan works to be particularly revealing of what resonated in the community about a given work, and as such, they're really interesting in themselves to analyze. In the case of Undertale art, before it degenerates into this weird self-evolving feedback loop of AUs and... There are a few interesting motifs which keep coming up again and again. I'm particularly struck by this reflection on the duality of the characters. It shows itself in a couple of different ways, but the reason this is such a prominent motif in fan art is that the theme of moral luck is central to the emotional reactions a lot of folks had in response to Undertale. And I think that's really the strongest evidence in favor of Undertale's lasting value. Not only that it affected people enough to motivate them to embarrass themselves on the internet, but it did so in such a way that made them more aware of and sensitive to themselves, others, and their place in the world. And it did it perceptibly. You can find pages of Google results of people talking about Undertale making them want to be a better person. And narrative art is supposed to change us for the better. Like, that's the dream, right? But how rare is it that a piece can consistently change people to a degree that they're immediately aware of it? Never mind games, that's a thing that's vanishingly rare among film and literature. Look, when I first conceived this, the whole angry sculpture man shouts philosophy jargon at you thing was new and kind of needed a parody. In reality, I just had a really moving and enriching experience and a dire need for it to be validated and to share it with others. As I said at the start, this isn't exhaustive. There's so much more that I wanted to talk about and more detail I wanted to go into, but just didn't have time for in this video. I'm sorry if any of that came off as glibness, but I realized the broad perspective actually serves my purpose. I don't want this to come off as, like, the definitive, authoritative last word on Undertale. I don't want to end these conversations. I want to start them. Undertale is really keen on being wide open to interpretation, and I think it's this complexity and subjectivity which is Undertale's biggest strength, that it can so easily be read in so many different ways, providing a rich text for analysis for a broad range of audiences and interests into posterity is a feature of a truly classic work. Disagree with me? Want to take something I said further? Go ahead and start talking critically. Frankly, Undertale and these formal ideas feel bigger than me, and mostly, I'm just really excited to see what you guys come out with when you play with them. I'm gonna have some more videos like this coming, and there's nothing you can do to stop me. So if you enjoyed this and you want more, then just absolutely destroy those like and subscribe and bell buttons. And share with all of your equally violent friends. Also, follow me on Twitter, because I like internet points. Okay, That's it. How do I...